board in September discussed it, but it wasn't on the agenda, and they approved $17,000, to put the handicap ramp in at Bloomfield. So those two items are coming out of that, are encumbered.
When was that?
In September, we discussed it, we voted on it in October 21st.
That was the $17,000?
That was the $17,000.
And the $20,000 was?
In August.
Was voted on and approved?
Yes. So we're basically at a balance, about a hun, without the $50,000, at $158,000.
Okay, well, let me just stop right there. What I would, so there's $257,000 in there, is that what I'm reading here?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so if there's $257,000 in there, including the contingent $50,000, you did use $20,000 in August, which the schedule just does not reflect, so that makes it $237,000. The $17,000 you just mentioned took place in October.
Correct.
So therefore, that doesn't affect the September 30 balance, and therefore shouldn't be considered. So I would recommend that we move $37,000 out if the $50,000 comes in, and if the $50,000 doesn't come in, then you're under $250,000.
No, actually, it's committed.
Well, if it remains, I mean, I'm just trying to simplify it.
Yeah, I'd like to get Mr. Saxon and I've had discussions on this, and I want to get some further clarification from Mr. Saxon.
I mean, if it's good money, then it should be counted if it's agreed. And if it's not good money, then it shouldn't, if it has to go back. So I think to simplify the discussion, that's, I don't know, unless Mr. Hiller disagrees with that philosophy.
It's fine.
Okay.
When are we going to know the disposition of the 50?
I don't know. What's the timing on that?
I'm sorry?
When are we going to know whether we...
I would think we're, yeah.
Okay.
Certainly prior to our next meeting.
So we can talk about it at the next meeting.
Okay. That's great. And then if anyone, so there may be a transfer of 37, there may not, depending on the 50. The October money, I don't think should count toward either transaction. And then the policy, if you guys want to take a look at the policy and see if anyone has any recommendations or changes to it, we can certainly take it under advisement and, if need be, review it at an upcoming meeting, or forward it. If that's fair. Anybody have any questions or comments? Mr. Polito.
Just a quick, somewhat non-related question. Melville Field looks great. Did you guys do that?
The
new infield?
Yeah, the public works is. No, I believe Louis did that.
Oh, they did, okay.
Yeah, they asked for permission.
Right. Looks great. Thank you.
Great. Well, the fields did look great this year.
Yeah.
Well, we're trying. Kevin and staff are doing excellent.
Yeah.
They should be commended for that. Great. Anything else that should touch on?
Just with the transfer of money, is the same person asleep?
No.
How are we doing next year?
We're moving along. We're hoping probably another 3 weeks. 2 or 3 weeks. They're going to, we'll know better than that. It's really going to be nice. It's going to look like a little park. There's going to be grass all the way around it, and there'll be grass in the center. And, I think I had to go down Friday and throw some kids off of it. A little bit. But I think it's going to work.
You have a little Grinch basket on?
Yeah, well, it wasn't fun. I mean, I was more concerned because it's, you know, it's not completed and there's it's a construction site.
Yeah. Fun but things to jump over, though.
It's going to be nice when they finish. We're going to let you people take the first roll around.
You have medics on hand? Make sure that
you want Mr. Colonel back.
That doesn't make our notes. I'm going to add it there.
Please put that in the minutes. All right. Anything else on this? Anything for the public on this item? I'm sorry. Hearing none. Thank you very much, Mr. LeVar.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure to see you.
Yes. Thank you. How do you like Munis?
Hello?
As a department head.
It's going to be a learning curve. I think, you know, someone made the mention that the department heads don't see the value yet. Of course we don't, because there's nothing in there.
Yeah.
Okay. We haven't rolled over the last year's monies to get that out. It's going to be a big learning curve. We're not going to see the value of it until probably a year from now. Okay. Change is difficult. I had it with my recreation. I told department heads when recreation software. And that was a smaller scale, and I had a smaller staff. There was a, I had to make sure everybody bought into it, and we had to change the way we do business. And that's what we have to do with this system. I find, from the user standpoint, our biggest problem right now is the reporting end. Because everything today in this technology today is crystal. The problem is nobody knows how to do crystal. And we have to get staff in town capable of doing it. So I can make a phone call and say, I want this report. You're correct, there's reports that people don't use, and I have that for recreation. And that we had developed a year or 2 years ago when we first got it, that we don't use anymore because we've learned different ways of doing this. But it's going to work. Don't expect a lot of data this year, particularly with the budgets. You're going to get information. But I think a year or 2 years down the road, I think when we have past history to work with, then we can move forward that way. But right now, and nobody ever used Phoenix, I can tell you right now. The only ones that used Phoenix was to put purchase orders in. Because we couldn't go in and find out how much money. I like, right now as a manager, I can go in and quickly look on the screen to see what I have as a balance in a particular line item. So I mean, it's going to work fine. It's just, it's a big learning curve, and it's frustrating because I want information that I can't get my hands on right now. So I think overall it will work, but it's in the purchasing end. I know that I think we have some policies that need to be reviewed that we've implemented when we put the system in. Okay. I think we have to sit back as department heads and Board of Finance, whoever implemented the policies, and say, why are we doing that? Okay. I'll give you an example. Right now, I used to just approve as department. Now I have basically, in order to get a purchase order approved, I think it goes through three or four different people, depending on what it's for. To me as a user, the department makes no sense. But we have to sit back and review the policy to see how to make things work better. And the other thing is, we used to go and buy things, okay? Maintenance, your office, they called their vendor and say, okay, I need, soil for tomorrow. Okay, they deliver the soil, then they put in the invoice and we do it. That's the way, you can't foresee the weather and what's going to happen to have all the stuff on hand to do it. Otherwise, you may be wasting money that way. So there's pros and cons to doing things the way we're doing it, but I think overall it will work. It's just going to be a year, maybe 2 years from now, I think we'll be very happy.
Thank you.
And I don't think you'll hear the complaints from all of us.
That's helpful. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.
Did they make you return the computer monitors?
Damn! Sorry. I hate when that happens.
Yes. Thanks, Jerry.
Yeah.
Have a good one.
Okay, we'll move to item number 6, which is to hear a report on the status of the state and federal grants for the town and for the Board of Education.
Thank you,
Mr. Hiller.
Distributed tonight to the board is basically two documents. One is a memo of the state budget after the adoption of the state budget from CCM. Tied into that, there's some other stuff that are not particularly relating to finances as far as legislation was passed actually on September 28th. More importantly for our purposes, the spreadsheet shows the what we had as a budget of just under $7 million for the 7 statutory grants, and what we've received to date, $3,314,000, what we anticipate receiving based on the adopted budget and the variance. I would add this, that if you on the resolved with OPM. As you'll see on the CCM sheet, we were slated to receive $2,535,000, and in fact received $2,509,000. And we don't have an explanation yet as to why we're short $26,000 on that particular grant. That grant was received.
Could somebody please tell us what page we're on?
I'm sorry?
I can't find the numbers.
This was a document that was handed to us tonight.
This is the page that wasn't in the packet that was mailed.
That's correct.
That's correct. It was handed out tonight.
This is the one we didn't have a chance for review before tonight.
That's correct, sir.
And this one? CCM?
Yeah, the CCM piece came tonight as well.
It's 17.
Budget.
And in fact, the adopted budget by the state has yet to be posted on the state website. So this is one of the difficulties, is finding out what we're going to get, when we're going to get it. I will say this, that the ECS grant was received, 25% was received on October 31st as anticipated. There are three payments on that, October 31st, January 31st, and April 30th, 25%, 25%, and 50%. We did email the board earlier this week some documents which Mrs. McQuain had presented to the Board of Education on the, called the stimulus money, which related to that 14.27% variance, which we modified the budget by back during the budget cycle.
If I may, Mr. Petro, this was your request for this meeting, I believe, the state grant request? Oh, was this the same?
That was just the Board of Ed.
Okay. I thought it was maybe a combination request or two. I guess my question is, do we have sufficient information here to have this discussion, and should we have it, or do we want to avoid doing it twice tonight and some other night because we don't have sufficient information?
What I find reforming between the new piece of paper and the other piece of paper, I don't see anything that ties us back to the budget. As I remember, the budget book was very confusing in terms of what was in ECS and what wasn't. And we've just had some new rulings as to what the MBR requirement is in relation to this. And what I see reforming doesn't step me through any of that, and I can't see numbers tying out to anything. So if somebody can step us through that, maybe we do, maybe we don't. My first blush would say it's no.
And that's why I wanted to ask, because if everything that we need isn't here to answer the questions from the previous meeting and the emails that were sent over, then maybe we should spend a couple minutes clarifying those points again as a request for follow-up versus doing this tonight and then doing this again in December. That's what I'm trying to avoid.
As far as the MBR requirements, so it's part of it. I thought we were really just looking at what had been adopted by the General Assembly. And where we were as budget, from a budget standpoint, I think the simplistic answer on the MBR question as a budget requirement is we're okay. Mrs. McQuain may have other information as far as that's concerned, but
first of all, can somebody tie this back to the budget book? Where are we versus where we are?
Well, I think the spreadsheet we gave out tonight shows that we are, and this would include, and I point out the $26,000 variance from OPM, that we are $274,528 short on these seven grants.
Yeah, you just lost me in all that, and I don't see anything that ties it back to the budget book in terms of which line items these numbers are in.
It says in the left column, Mr. Petro, the $6,995,000 is in the budget book. Those are the seven statutory grants which we take as revenue in the general fund.
Is the $3,072,000 the ECS number broken out in the budget book at all?
Yes.
No. I have the budget in front of me, page 17 revenue. There's one number. Line 41, old 4100, three zeros. It matches that number exactly.
So it is broken out.
just one number. It's called General Education Grant. Again, if you have your books, page 17.
Page 17, right, which is the same number.
And one of the numbers is on page 18. Pequot Fund is on 18.
And directly below that is the School Transportation Grant, which we had estimated at 10,431. And the other five grants are in another category of state grants other than education.
So when we refer to final budget, is that the final town budget or the final state budget?
The $6,995 is our estimates as approved by this board back in April or
so
that's, March.
Those numbers are in the final town budget?
Yes.
Okay. And you're going to tie that back to what was approved by the state at some point?
And what has been approved by the state? Roughly just short of half of what we anticipate receiving and what we will receive over the next 8 months essentially is the balance of that, which would mean from a budgetary standpoint, we are $274,000 short on these accounts.
I'm trying to tie back to the issue. And it says ECS grant.
On page
3 of that memo. The ECS number here, ECS grant, is adopted budget for fiscal year 10 is $3,590,008.
That number includes the monies that have been or will be received by the town, by the Board of Education through the stimulus money, which is approximately
$512,000. And that's detailed further down in that spreadsheet.
So if I take this $3,072,000, add $512,000 to that, I come up with $3,005,000,084. Is there some number where I see $3,005,000,084? I believe Ms. McQuain said that the 512 is the one missing. If we add that to the 3072, then we should have 3584, unless there's another component.
Those are various, but if you 3.72 is actually 3.73. Well, the variance from budget is 5,000. That may be a difference.
I guess we could spend all night going through this and trying to. I'd like something that ties all this stuff out so we know where we stand. So the issue is, what did we approve in our budget? What did the state approve? And how do we tie this back to ECS? And the follow-on question will be, because of the minimum budget requirement, because we got such a confusing mess last year in budget season, it would be very nice with 3 or 4 months ahead of time understand how the new wording in the minimum budget requirement impacts ECS. So going into the budget requirement, as much as the state will still be behind us, that we have some way of evaluating where we stand versus where we can be. Because again, I'm anticipating this to be a very, very difficult budget year. And I think we all need to know where we stand and doing stuff on the fly is very difficult. So I guess what I'm looking for is something that steps us through that. Because I think that's the decision we have to make. We're not trying to manage the grants. Just trying to understand the impact on the town where we stand. For Mr. Chair, that's at least what I was trying to do.
Understood. Go ahead.
I can certainly put that on one page for you and show you how it all ties together, or I can also walk you through it right now if you like. If you want to look at your choice. So.
If you can walk us through it, that's great.
Okay.
Very slow.
On the page that I had that was emailed to you that is headed up SFSF funding totals on 9/10.
Yes.
This is how I was explaining to the Board of Education how the dollar value of the 512,168 was arrived at. You remember when we were in the budget process last year, the word down the street was that the state was going to be giving us what they called stimulus funds called SFSF, and that the town could, in fact, reduce the allocation to the Board of Education by the amount that at that time was being projected, which was the 502601, first number on that spreadsheet. And in fact, the RTM did that. They reduced our budget appropriation by that amount of money because the funding was going to come directly to the Board of Education through the state rather than going as a lump sum total to the town as a part of the ECS grant. So that was why you could reduce our operating budget. In fact, we were notified right after I had done the board meeting with the board where we had decided how we were going to be allocating that 502,000, that the state was going to be funding that at just slightly over the 502. They were using a calculation of 14.27% of the ECS grant from the prior year. And that was the amount of money that was going to come to us directly as the Board of Education rather than going to the town as part of the ECS grant. They further clarified it to say, and we are going to give that to you in two separate grants. One is going to be called the RS Stabilization Ed Grant, and the other is the RS Stabilization Government Service Grant. I don't really know why they divided it up that way, but that's their choice. So that 168 is divided into the 330, 142, and the 182, 026. The bottom line is we report this to the state, our expenditures on a monthly basis, and it is handled like every other grant that we have to administer through the town, through the Board of Education. Now, to your point, in our budget document, we had carried the same ECS total as 0809 in the 0910 column in our budget document on our grants page. That's what we were projecting. That's how we did our budget. By virtue of just explaining to you what the grant amounts were and where we were coming from. The town used a different number. Mr. Hiller had the 3072806. He had subtracted out, I believe, the SFSF funding that was going to come directly to us. So we each had a bit of an adjustment. He, in fact, is going to be getting slightly more. That's that delta there of $5,034. And we, in fact, got more, the $9,000, above the 502 that we thought we were getting. We had conversations with Mr. Hiller and Mr. Flato about what you want us to do with that extra $9,000. And they said carry it as the SFSF funding as a part of that grant total. So that's what we were doing. That's why I had to go back to the Board of Education again to reinstate a little bit more money into our technology budget than had been reduced. Does that answer the first part of your question, or do you have?
Could I just add this? When General Assembly already realized this had happened. I mean, we were one of the first, I won't say the only, but one of the very, very few communities that caught this back in April. What was going on? Because of the change in this, we had the right to go back through the process, through the Board of Selectmen, Board of Finance, and RTM, to take back this $9,500 or to amend the Board of Education budget. In conversation with the first selectman, it was frankly a nominal amount, and over all other difficult times, we both made a little bit of money on this. We decided not to go through the process on that for the nominal amount of money that was involved.
To your next question,
it's two levels. I think this year's, unless there's an impact on this year. My standpoint, I'm worried about when we're approving the budget next year, what's the target where we stand based on the role today, and I believe it will extend for the next 2 years.
It does. It's for 0910 and 0911. And if I can just read to you from Brian Mahoney, who was at the State Department of Education. to summarize the 09-10, and I can make a copy of this for you, it was in an email to actually the first selectman. To summarize the 09-10-10-11 minimum budget requirements, MBR, pursuant to section 10-260-21. For both 09-10 and 10-11, the Board of Education's minimum appropriated budget must be at least at the level of their 2008-2009 budgeted appropriation, including any supplemental appropriations that may have occurred in 08-09, minus the funds received under the state fiscal stabilization funds, that's the SFSF, $502,168.
That's not the 512,
which for Fairfield equals 512,168. The 09-10-10-11 MBR requires the same local effort that was provided in 08-09. The intent of the MBR for 09-10 and 10-11 is to, one, not require additional local tax dollars over 08-09, and two, prohibit a reduction of the local tax dollars over 08-09. Any town which fails to meet the MBR will be subject for a penalty in the fiscal year 2 years subsequent. It's 2 years subsequent. In an amount of two times the shortfall, the penalty will be in the form of a reduction to the ECS grant. So for Fairfield, this means that our 08-09 budget was 139,614,137. We subtract out what we received in this year for the SFSF funding of the 512,168. That leaves us with 139,101,969. Our 09-10 appropriated budget is 139,563,360. So we're good for this year.
And fiscal year 11.
Yeah. The answer to the question that I don't know is, what is the SFSF funding level going to be for 10-11? I am not sure of that. So if I can get the answer to that question, then we pretty much know what we have to be doing or where we have to be at a minimum budget requirement. But I don't know what that amount to be subtracted off of our 08-09 total is going to be. If it's going to be carried at the same amount and we're going to get that 2 years running, then we have to be at 139,101,669. We are slightly over that this year by $461,391.
Does it mention in there adjusting that, or it sounded like the way you read that, it just sounds like it establishes the base based on 2008.
It's a 2008
minus
appropriation.
Minus the 500,000.
That's correct.
And that's the base.
So that's the base.
It
I'm assuming, but I, you know. Okay.
And that's what I'm trying to get to, what it says there versus what either you're reading into it or perhaps you've heard from other channels.
I have not heard anything from anyone.
So if we're just going
saying, based on that, 139,101,969 is the number.
And it sounds like that is the base period, unless they clarify that, for lack of a better term.
That was the right term.
And change the base going forward. Short of that, if that's the only wording there is, that says, hey, just don't go below that number from now to forever. But there wasn't, if I remember correctly, it was an issue that this MBR only impacted us if the ECS grant was higher year to year. And it sounds like they've taken that away and saying
they did.
Okay, that the MBR is here regardless of what the state does in whatever budget hardship they get into. If they were to, for some reason, give us less ECS money, that wouldn't change our minimum budget requirement the way that is worded. Historically, that would have taken us out of the game and it wouldn't matter. This is saying, guys, no matter what we do with ECS, you've got to maintain that number or we will penalize you in the future by reducing ECS even more. Am I saying that correctly?
Yes.
I agree. Yes. Thank you for that clarification and explanation. Okay. With that said, back to the schedule. Do we have any further questions on the state grant schedule? Mr. Flynn.
Thanks for the clarification going forward.
Couple things. Mr. Hiller, it sounds to me like tonight, it's been indicated to us, if I have the materials correct, that we've got a budget hole in the current fiscal year, just taking into account what we've heard tonight, of about $425,000, which would be $274,000 shortfall on expected funding from the state, and $150,000 shortfall in our budgeting for heart and hypertension. And if I recall back in our last quarterly meeting, we were concerned about overtime costs related to police or fire, I can't remember which one, which were running at a very high percentage through the first quarter. And then there was some softness, but we weren't sure it was early in the year, regarding some of the revenue line items.
That is correct. I think the good news has been we're waiting for some reports from Mr. Gorzolani, who had surgery last week, on where we are basically through the October collection period, which really has just ended because of the ability to
get us more. I mean, since we a high collection rate, right?
Slightly below what we achieved last year.
Yeah. What are we budgeting at? My point being that most of what he's going
to... We budgeted at 98.76.
Right.
Right.
So I guess what I'm saying is that's mostly going to be a timing issue. Maybe we get a little bit extra interest compared to the 98.76.
I think my concern there on the tax standpoint, the good news on the tax standpoint that we talked about last time,
right,
is we've had significant collections on the delinquent taxes, which has boosted that account significantly. But my most immediate concern is on the supplemental taxes, which go out for new vehicles. We know right now that number is down, I don't have the exact number, but it is down statewide. One of the problems that the assessor's office is having, State Motor Vehicle Department just rediscovered 35,000 vehicles in the state, distributing that out, so we don't have a good number there. Right now, we were down 1,800 vehicles over last year on new vehicles. And now that's just an arbitrary number for supplemental taxes. We have estimated a 30% reduction in that line, and it'd probably be another 3 to 4 weeks before we really have a handle on that. So that's one that's in play. The other big lines that we've always looked at, obviously, are conveyance tax. Right now, for 4 months, just on transactions, we're down 17% below the same 4 months last year.
It sounds as though you're saying we have a potential budget shortfall here.
I don't know that we have a potential budget shortfall because, as you recall, that those the conveyance tax numbers really really fell apart in the 6 month period from November through April last year.
Yeah.
And so the bar, or let's say our bogey that we've got to hit, is very low for the next 6 months, whether we're going to be able to achieve that or not. But I know that the number of transactions for the 4 month period is down 17.7%. Interest income continues to stay down, and today continued the policy, and building permits are also down.
So as I said, it looks like we have a budget shortfall.
We have some concerns. We've got some areas that naturally, which are, I mentioned the delinquent tax area, we did receive today $185,000. From CRA. I spent several hours today at the CRA offices in Hartford with my counterpart from Norwalk. I think we're going to get more money from them before the end of the fiscal year on balances that they're holding for us. And we argued, I think, persuasively to that extent today.
Mr. Donovan, was that in the budget?
Sorry?
Was any of that in the budget?
No. and we received the check for ID.
But that's a one time, right?
So, and I would anticipate it would be another.
That's what I thought.
Oh, 50 to 75 thousand coming in on that.
But again, that's a one time pop, right?
That's correct.
Could we get a schedule? I would think that you, first of all, at this point, given what I'm hearing, a little bit concerned. Can we get a schedule together for the December meeting that kind of shows where we are?
On the revenues?
On the revenues, as well as large expense items like these that you know of?
Yeah, and I think, you know, the hot buttons, we're scheduled to meet with the three largest departments, Public Works, Police, and Fire, next week to review where they are on a four-month basis and have a better handle on that. I think you know very well where some of those areas are, particularly in Police and Fire, it's the overtime accounts.
I would like to get a handle on that. I'd love to see a schedule next meeting on what you and the first selectman are looking at to indicate to yourselves how we stand for this year. Because this, only because this is two meetings in a row where we found negative variances in either revenue or too high in expenses. And I remember the, I don't want to call it emergency meeting, but special meeting we had late last year. And I just want to see where we are relative to that. If you don't mind. So it'd be great to have that. So we can all be on the same page in early December.
All right, so Deb, could you please put into the minutes for our December meeting two things, an item to discuss, the schedule, and schedule the revenue and or extraordinary expenses that we need to talk about at that December meeting. Okay? So that we don't have to have a revenue discussion tonight on the fly. Okay?
Thank you, Deb. Thank you, Mr.
I think Mr. DeWitt was next, and then this is it. Hey, we're on this state grant schedule. That's the item before us, so
right.
I'd like to pull us back to that. Right?
Yeah, no, I'm with you. I see this. My original question was, it appeared as if we, if there's $512,000 that's not included in our revenue number, did we understate revenue?
No, the 500, we became aware last spring, and the 500, we had figured it was 502, it was, the RTM adjusted the budget by, at virtually the last minute, and the revenue was adjusted. We did not.
But our revenue book doesn't show that. Our revenue book shows us 307,2806. It should have been 3.5.
What we anticipate, the 5.502 or the 5.12 is not in this document, and
because it's being handled differently this year from the state, it's not being included as ECS money directly to the town. The state was using a part of that stimulus money that they received to reduce the ECS payment to the town, and they issued it as a grant to the school district. It could not be a part of the ECS total. And as Paul stated, we were ahead of the curve in figuring this out last year when it came time for the RTM to actually vote the revenue number versus our operating budget. A lot of towns didn't even catch on to this until much later on when this number was published, and all of a sudden some of the towns were scrambling to say, well, now wait a minute. They also came out with a ruling that said, and remember towns, if you have not adjusted your school district's budget to take out this SFSF money that we're going to give to the to the Board of Education, you have the right to do that at any point in time.
And that was the first time that was a one-shot legislation, and that really was the legislation that, as I say, that we could have taken the 9,500.
Correct.
Okay. But after that, it was an insignificant amount of taken through the whole process.
Yeah.
It wasn't worth the effort.
Okay. And then my next question is to expand on Mr. Flynn's question, 400 and change. We made a transfer, heart hypertension, 9-1 of $270,000.
That's in the 09 fiscal year budget.
That was last year's fiscal year. Okay, so that doesn't impact, it doesn't further impact our. Great.
Thank you. All right, Mrs. Ethan, Mr. Mayor, who I missed.
This is okay. You had other items in the Board of Education budget that were grants from the state. How are those coming in?
Some of them we still don't know yet. Right now, on the grants that would go to the town, all we have are the numbers that we budgeted.
Right.
We don't have confirmation on that. And on most of the other grants, we have very little change at all.
So it's what you budgeted?
Pretty much what we have in our budget document looks to be the revenue that we're receiving. They were very, very late, and in some cases haven't given an award yet because everything got delayed at the
right.
state level.
Right.
So in some of these cases, we're really hoping we're going to get what we had budgeted.
But the ones you know you are
yes.
getting more or less.
Yes.
Okay.
Very, very close to what we had hoped for.
Good. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor.
On this statutory grant, is the Mohegan, Pequot Mohegan budget anticipated amount of 368,617? It was identical to the amount, the typo. Should be 368,617. And should that number really be what's closer to us in the CCM document of 297,738? And if so, that would be another shortfall of 71,000. And it's actually.
If we had other information that was given to us other than what we got from CCM on this, then frankly.
It seems weird to exactly the same.
I'm sorry?
It seems very strange they're the exact same number.
Yeah. I will clarify that and get that back to you tomorrow.
And then secondly, is the other minor differences, like in the private university, which is, you know,
26,000
difference.
There's 26,000, which I have called OPM twice last week and said, you know, we seem to be short. One of the problems. With OPM is finding the right person who's got the right answer.
And the town aid is $1,000 difference. So, but the big one is the Pequot Mohegan.
Right. I noticed that. I will clarify that and get that back to you tomorrow.
I'm very surprised being the fourth person to on this board to talk on this issue. That's the first one.
I think we should point out to Mr. Mayor that we all discussed that previously, but we won't bring him around.
We discussed it in the first time.
It's benefit being last minute. Just to clarify in terms of how these grants work, very often we get grants and there's costs associated with them. We're going to perform, if we don't get the grant, we don't do the work. Are there any expense reductions to go along with this $274,000, or have we approved the expenses and we're spending the money and we just didn't get the revenue?
I think the latter. We've approved expenditures and they're not going to receive monies to cover our budgetary costs. There's no, essentially, with the exception of the LOSIP grant, in which we have to show various capital projects. Normally we file on that for asphalt paving program, which we have, and get that. There are, I'll say, virtually no strings attached to any of these particular grants. There can be some offsets on the ECS grant relating back both positive and negative to excess costs. We won't know that until probably March.
But that would be contained within the school budget, and from a town standpoint, that money is basically already, so if the ECS grant comes in higher, the school gets the budget, you keep that in mind.
The town.
Comes back to town.
And it is varied. Over probably the last 10 years, the town has come out ahead. This past year, we were adversely impacted by $190,000.
So basically, during the budget process, we do our best to guess what these grant amounts will be. And we don't really have a contingency in case we guess wrong.
That's right.
Mrs. Z?
I'm sorry, one more thing I wanted to ask you. On this CCM, it indicates that the legislature was passing a bill to delay the in-school suspension for a year.
Did they pass that? They did pass that.
Okay, because in the sheet at the second page that you sent us, there's $42,548 for two paras for in-school suspension.
They did not pass that. They did have. I'm sorry, I heard your question wrong. No, we had hoped that they would pass it to waive it for one more year.
They did not.
We had to put them back in.
Okay, thank you.
And may I just clarify one other thing that I said to you? The one grant that we know is really up in the air right now is this ECS grant. That's the special ed reimbursement. It's an excess cost reimbursement grant for expenditures that exceed 4.5 times our per pupil expenditure for our special needs children, for which we receive a significant amount of money. We heard last week that it looks like, and again, this is one that the state hasn't determined yet, but we have been funded at 100% after the 4.5 times per pupil rate. And that's what we currently have in our budget. We have a projection of we would be at 100%. They are now talking about 77%. They are looking at capping the dollar amount. And we really don't have a clue yet what that will translate to us until there are filing periods for our excess cost ministers. The first one is December 1st. Unfortunately, that's, we're well into our budget process by the time that happens. And what they do is we file our projected excess cost reimbursement totals by youngster, by textbook, by fringe benefit, by teacher hour, contact hour of other teachers. I mean, it's a huge job to do. We do that on December 1st. What the state does is they take all the towns that are filing and they put them all together to come up with a total. And then they say, we have so much money and we're going to divvy that pot up to fund you at a certain level. And so that's where we really are worried right now for what's going to happen with that grant. And we don't have any better information than the number of 77% was thrown out there, and that's all we know.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anything else from board members on this item? Comments from the public on this item? Very good. Thank you to both of you. Appreciate it. Thank you. Okay, we'll move to item number 7, which is to review the credit card policy and documentation for the town and the Board of Education. Good evening and welcome.
This is Snow Bigrooms, the internal auditor.
Good evening.
Good evening, Mrs. Snowby. Welcome.
Thank you. The town credit card program, excuse me. Credit card program was implemented approximately 10 years ago by the purchasing department. Currently, there are 63 credit card holders from both the town and Board of Ed, their employees. There are limits placed on their credit card purchases, and these limits are applied by the director of purchasing, and she bases them on the types and amounts of purchases that they make. About 10 years ago, I compiled a credit card program, which the credit card holders review and sign, and they are currently obligated to comply by these rules and procedures. And within the these rules and procedures, they are to submit supporting documentation for all their purchases, and which they are to are reviewed by their department head, and they're returned to the accounting department. And the accounting department, what they do is apply the purchases to the general ledger accounts accordingly. I gave you a 6-page document which shows what the policies and procedures are. I don't know if you had a chance to review them. But if you have any questions, feel free to let me know.
Thank you, Mrs. Melvin. Mr. Molina.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Question I have. Earlier tonight, we had the update on the Muni system from Mr. Bremer, and there was talk about controls, and one of the things that he mentioned that we were trying to avoid was people going off and purchasing things on their own. Given that trend in terms of the philosophy of purchasing for the town, do we need a credit card program anymore?
Well, the credit card program does come in handy when people are going on seminars and travel and meeting and that sort of thing, or if they need a credit card to reserve a room at a hotel, go out for their meals and business expenses, things like that.
In terms of what you just mentioned, the seminars and travel, there are line items in the budget that cover such items. What is done to tie the money spent on these credit cards to the budget line item to make sure that those amounts are not exceeded?
They do, when a credit card holder makes an expenditure on the credit card, they have to submit their receipt with the general ledger account number that is to be applied to, which is the travel and meeting account. So it's always charged to that account when an expenditure occurs.
And in your opinion, the majority of purchases that are made through the credit card program, would you say that the majority are on travel and seminars or on small purchasing group departments? Where do you see the bulk of the purchases being made?
A lot of purchases are travel and meeting. I know recreation department uses quite a bit, the credit card quite a bit, because they do purchase tickets for Broadway shows and things like that, which are done through the credit card program. Public works department uses it quite a bit because the mechanics might find that they need supplies right away for certain vehicles, and they send someone out to purchase parts and things like that.
I guess what concerns me is the fact that, well, it seems it's a very convenient way to handle relatively minor expenses. It does seem to run counter to the philosophy that the implementation of Munis is going toward, which is to have greater control over spending and purchasing, even for relatively small items. So I'm just wondering how we're gonna reconcile that going forward. In terms of who gets the card, what determining factors are made? How does one get a card? What are the qualifications that need to be met?
Usually it goes through the department head. An employee will request it to their department head. The department head will go to the director of purchasing, and she'll make the determination based on the types and amounts of purchases that they make, and she'll authorize.
Is there ever an instance where a card is taken away from an employee based upon their spending habits changing, it's determined they don't need it anymore, there's abuse of it? Have there been any instances of any of those things?
Employees, if they find that they do not use the credit card, they will return it.
They make that determination, the employee, or is that
sometimes the employee will say, look, I haven't used it, I really don't have a need for it, let me return it, rather than have it sitting out there.
Is there an instance where the town requests it back?
Not to my knowledge.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor.
When this was discussed in the last previous board meeting.
Can you speak into the mic, please?
When this was discussed last previous board meeting, someone mentioned, I don't remember who it was, that almost all the credit card vouchers, the credit card bills that are paid are supported by some form of documentation.
Yes.
And the troubling words there were almost all. Why wouldn't it be all?
It is all. It is there. Each employee is required to submit supporting documentation for every purchase that they make.
According to this TWIG statement, that's not happening.
On occasion, some employees fail to submit receipts. And when that happens, we usually call the department head and have them submit a receipt. Sometimes the employee may lose a receipt. If that happens, then they must submit some form of documentation, written documentation stating what they purchased, why, when, where, the amount, and so on, and have it approved by their department.
Mr. Flynn and Mr. DeWitt.
Jamie, how often do you, in your capacity as internal auditor, test the credit card processes to make sure that everything's working as the policy design sets out?
I usually do a biannual to annual review of credit card.
And what have the results of your reviews been in recent periods?
In the past, some of the audit findings have been employees failing to submit the proper receipts.
Do they still get processed without the proper? Have you found that they've failed to submit, but yet they've been processed?
Usually that bill is not paid, and it will not be paid until the employee submits the proper receipts.
So the control in that aspect is working?
Yes.
Okay. Have you found any instances of abuse or any instances of questionable expenses?
Whenever I find something that looks peculiar, I will contact the employee and ask them what that purchase was, why did they make that, and it's always a bona fide, justified reason. It might be, sometimes it looks unusual when you see it on a credit card bill, and when you question it, it's always some form of a document purchase.
Do the auditors look at it at all, our external auditors?
I don't believe that they review the credit.
I don't know that. I think that they know it's there. I would say this: on annual average, this program probably has between the town and Board of Education, probably the town, in the neighborhood of $300,000 in expenditures total. So, you know, $25,000 a month. What plus or minus?
Which gets to my question: what kind of cards are they? Do you get an annual statement that lists all the expenditures put on the card for the year, or types of expenditures, classifications?
Yes.
And that's reviewed to make sure that
I purchase it.
Okay. I have. How often is the listing of approved cardholders reviewed? Do you know?
I check it probably every quarter to make sure that employees who retire or their credit cards are.
Do we ever, Mr. Hiller, I guess this would be more for you, do you ever have the department heads or purchasing review who's had the cards issued? To your earlier comments about really not taking them back, for the most part, do you ever institute a review and say, you know, this person does not need
a card? Yeah, and it's a question also of utilization.
Well, that's right.
Is there a need for, you can see here there's a predominance, a lot of it's in the public works area. Building maintenance, auto repairs, and stuff like that.
Right.
There's an immediate need for some material or a part, something like that. And that's where you see that. I would add this also, that all of these cards have restrictions. In other words, the people who are for public works, I think there's three or four cards that are unrestricted. Mine being one, Dr. Clark's being one. And when I say restricted, it's to what they can use. They can't use it for car rentals. They can't use it for hotels. They can't use it for travel. They can't use it for meals. And so there's certain categories that they're restricted on.
You bring up a good point, because I also noticed to your earlier point that there's spending limits on each of the card. And the question both of those items raised to me is, are those what I would refer to as after the fact restrictions?
No, those are front end restrictions.
Card
is issued.
So that, okay.
So if we have a person who might be the parts, what's called the parts runner for public works,
right,
who has one of these cards.
Right.
He can't buy food, he can't buy lodging, he can't, you know.
Well, my question to can't buy is, is it shouldn't buy, or if they go to use the card, it's actually denied?
It's been rejected.
It is denied, so
yeah,
it's very specific to the card.
There are categories of goods or services which can be used, and
that's monitored by American Express.
That's monitored by American Express, and that's a front end.
Yeah, that's great. No, that's what I want. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Mr. Whit?
It's a very similar policy to my company where, you know, if you travel, you can, lodging, food,
yeah,
it's, I'm struck though that there's a lot of parks and rec, public works and stuff, but I don't see a lot of the department heads. Like, for example, Mr. Saxwell's not in here. I don't see Mr.
Saxwell's not a full-time employee.
Mr. or Mrs. Brown, who I know attend a lot of seminars and stuff like that. So, which leads me to my next question. So, I won't pick on Mrs. Brown, but Mrs. Brown attends a seminar for town clerks, does not have a corporate credit card. I'm assuming she pays with her own credit card and then gets reimbursed through the town?
Correct. Some employees choose not to have town credit cards. And what they do is they will make purchases on their own and they will submit the receipts and we will reimburse them.
So that same procedure in the back that holds true for credit card holds true for any
yes. Or else they'll have the town pay in advance for it through the town purchasing system for a set amount.
Oh, okay. All right. Thank you.
Stone.
Bottom line, any problems in years? Any real problems?
No, there haven't been any real problems. As I said, just sometimes employees forget to submit the receipts and that sort of thing. We have to get diligent with that.
But the program's working.
Just a couple of quick questions. Are there annual fees with these cards?
No, there's no annual fees.
No membership fee per year for each card?
You get back every quarter about $6.03 or so. Some time of fees because you get some bonus points if you use certain 1-800-Flowers.com. We're restricted. Primarily, some of the rail car agencies, you can get some extra few points which come back somewhere.
So there's no annual fees that will.
I don't think that the checks we get back in. $25.
Can we get miles?
Yeah.
The answer is no.
Okay. Last question is, I don't know who the people are or what they do. It just, when I glance through the list, is anyone actively using the card? Like, for instance, I mean, not to pick on anyone, but I'm not quite sure why six people in the library have a card, or four people in conservation. I mean, obviously, it's because, why don't I let you answer the question?
Not all of these 63 cardholders use them at all times. I believe that for perhaps when you see three or four people at the library, perhaps if one person's out on vacation, someone else has a card and they can make the purchase, that sort of thing. Usually the department head makes the determination how many and who will have a card in their department.
They're buying books on Amazon a lot of times.
Are they?
Okay. That's where they're getting
it. I'm sure it was an explanation, but I just didn't know what it was.
Great.
Any further questions on this item? Questions from the public on this item? Hearing none, thank you very much. It's nice to see you.
Thank you. Nice to see you, too.
All right, we're just about done here. Number 8, item number 8, hear and act upon any communications. Mr. Hiller. Number nine, to hear, consider, and act upon any other business which shall properly come before this meeting. I've got one, but I see some hands. Go ahead.
Budget process, is that what you're going to say?
Well, I want to get together with you and Bob.
Okay.
And Rob.
I guess.
Yeah.
All right.
So if we could coordinate calendars maybe after this.
If this is something you're going to get together to discuss, when did you get together?
Yeah.
Okay.
First of all, a moment of personal privilege. I want to congratulate Mr. Kiley on his reelection last evening. Welcome Mr. Brockfeld and Mr. Brown to the board. And most importantly, I want to thank Mrs. Zeef and Mr. Mayor for their years of service and dedication. Thank them for being very good colleagues and for their service to the town. So congratulations. Best of luck. Don't be strangers.
For notes, well.
For notes, well.
Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Flynn. And I just would like to echo Mr. Flynn's comments in welcoming our new members, myself. Mr. Brockfeld and Mr. Brown, who will be joining us in December. And I, in all seriousness, I really do want to thank Mr. Mayor and Mrs. Z for their contributions to this board over the years. It has been a pleasure working with you and sitting next to you and making our town a better place. So thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
Speak into the mic, Mike.
For one
would you? Before I depart, I'd like to say a couple of things. One, I've essentially enjoyed the 6 years I've served in this board. I've enjoyed learning about how the town government works. I've enjoyed working with the members of the board, town officials, department heads, and staff. I've also enjoyed and taken a great deal of pleasure in observing the growth and professional development of this board over the 6 years that I've served, including but not limited to an improved understanding of the financials of the town, especially in the areas of understanding detail of the revenue accounts and certain liability accounts, identifying and executing improvements to the budget process, encouraging, supporting, and working with the town to acquire and implement a new financial software system, working to encourage implementation and improve internal controls, and really important, transcending the attitude of partisanship that prevailed in this board when I joined, and working in a very close, bipartisan manner. Finally, I would like to compliment Mr. Kiley regarding his maturation and his duties as chair. Congratulate you on your re-election and compliment you on your continued willingness to serve. I have one recommendation for the future, and that is to document and keep track of all the policies that we talk about and vote on and get forgotten or lost and then recalled sometime down the road. And this document we're going to use both as a reference material is educational material for new board members. In closing, I'd like to just say again, it's been a real pleasure working with each of you, and good luck in the future.
Yes, ma'am. This is it, please.
Yes, we both have been sitting here together, basically. I just can't believe that 7 years has gone so quickly. I don't know if you feel that way. You know, I was six, I had seven. And while the time has been well spent, it hasn't always been easy. Glad to see also that in the last 2 years we've moved away from partisanship to focus on more thorough understanding of the financial issues facing the town, improving the board's procedures and the overview of different areas, and I really am proud to be part of this. I would like to suggest one idea for Mr. Hiller and the chairman, and that's I think you need a workshop, new members, and this is really a good time to talk about it because you're having new members, and which could explain, among other things, the Board of Finance roles and the responsibilities, government accounting, the different funds used, the pension information, what the post-retirement benefits are, and my favorite, the audit and what it's supposed to tell us. The departments of the town, the Board of Ed needs, and the budget process we go through. And I think it would be really helpful to new members. So I hope that you'll take that into consideration. It's been great working with all of you. I'm going to really miss it, and I thank you for being so supportive.
Thank you.
The last 5 years.
Are you taking notes to GM?
Right.
I was like Sam Weisinger, like Sam lost all of his hands, right over his house.
He had a room full of stuff.
He said, "Bob, it's all you."
Thanks, and best of luck to both. Anything else for board members?
Move to adjourn.
No. Mr. Mayor, second by Mrs. Z. All those in favor?
Aye.